So today I want to talk about clustering, and I want to start with K-means, which is the de facto standard, or let's say the hello world algorithm when it comes to clustering. So let's have a look. So we have now a table which contains three columns, X, Y, Z, and some data, but we have no idea how these data items are belonging together, and that's where clustering kicks in. So as we can see here, if we plot this data into a 3D scatter plot, we clearly can see that this data contains three clusters. Okay, this is of course data which I made up, so this data is not something you will find in a real world scenario, but I think it's a very good data set for illustrating how a clustering algorithm works. As you can see here, I've added two additional dimensions, A and B, and now it's a bit harder to just plot it into a 3D scatter plot. Therefore, now we are completely dependent on an algorithm. So now let's see how to use k-means in order to cluster data. And we are using a particular data set, which is taken from a university. The link you can find below. And the data is generated by accelerometer sensors, which have been attached to bodies. And those people have been recorded during different exercises and movement patterns. So for example, climbing a stair or brushing teeth. And we will now use this data set in order to see whether we can find clusters in order to distinguish between them. As usual, the biggest part in every data analytics process is data loading, data ingestion. So this is also the case here. So what we have to do first is I'm setting the working directory to the location where my data resides in. And the data looks like the following. So let's have a look. So that's the path. That's the HMP data set. And for example, there is a brush teeth folder. And in that folder, there are a couple of text files. And let's have a look at one of those text files. So 4 and then we have 28. So as you can see, those are only the three dimensions of the accelerometer. So X, Y, and Z. And it's not even a comma separated file. So we will have some, we have a little challenge in order to load this data, but let's see how to do it in R. So the first thing I do is I create a function capable of just ingesting all this data. So the first thing is I read all the file names of a particular folder. So for example, I'm reading all the files from the brushing teeth example. And then what I do, I'm using lapply. So that's a functional programming style. I'm using lapply in order to add the folder name to the file name, which is particularly important, but it's only a little detail. But here comes the most important part. So I'm using lapply, the file name, and the read CSV function. So I'm applying the read CSV function to every file, which creates a data frame for each file. And then at the end, I'm using rbind to create one data frame out of all the data frames for the files, okay? And then what I do is I add a class label to each data frame that at a later stage I can make out where this data was coming from. So for example, I tell brushing teeth is class label 1 and going the stairs up is class label 2. I will use that later in order to assess the performance of my clustering algorithm. Then what I do is I assign column names to the data frame and then I return it, okay? So let's load this function. So what I do now is I create a data frame 1, out of the brushing teeth dataset. So let's have a look at this data frame. So you see here, that's the class, that's 1, because brushing teeth I defined is class 1. And then there are the accelerometer values for X, Y, and Z. Okay, so now let's have a look how this data looks like. So what you can see here is there are far too many data points for a plot, but what you can see is that those three dimensions have different means. So that's maybe interesting at a later stage. And maybe they have a different standard deviation. That's something we can figure out later. But in order to have a better look and a better view at those data, we just sample. So let's take only 500 of those data points. And then let's have a look how this plot looks like. So that's a bit better. You still can see that the means are different. That's an important property. So for example, X is, I guess, around 30. Y is around, let's say, 50. And C is around 40. And I have the feeling that the standard deviation of X is quite high, but we will figure this out later. So now let's load a second data set. That's the climb stairs data set. And here I assign class label 2. So let's have a look at those data. Again, this is a data frame. You see here class label 2, XYZ. And then we just use rbind to combine those two data frames into one single. And now we have data of both folders in one single data frame. And now we can basically just run k-means, as I already know that there are only two clusters in this data set, or I'm hoping that there are only two clusters in this data set because they are basically coming from two different activity types. So let's define number of clusters equals to 2. And then number of examples is n. It's always a good idea to have defined n as the number of examples. Who knows if you need it later. And now we are running k-means. To make it a bit more simple, I'm just using x and y of this data set. And I'm running the determine number of clusters function in order to see how the inter-cluster sum of squared error is decreasing. So let's have a look at this. As we can see here, it starts already with number of clusters 2 to decrease, but we can clearly see that it approximates 0. And of course, if you have equal number of clusters than data points, you are basically having you're basically having 0. But now we will go for 2 because we know that there are basically two clusters in the data set. And we are running k-means. So km is an object which is returned by the k-means algorithm, and km contains the cluster assignment for each data point. So you see here 2 and 1 are the cluster assignments. And in this case, we have a labeled data set. Of course, we are here explaining unsupervised machine learning, but as we have the label already here present in the data set, we can basically assess the quality of this clustering algorithm. So these are the real cluster assignments, and those are the cluster assignments which k-means returns. And actually, we can then decide how many class assignments have been correct and how many have been wrong. So these are the good ones, and these are the bad ones. And if we divide good over good plus bad, then we get 0.8325. So we have a 83% of accuracy, which is not bad. As I already told you, we have only the raw data, so we haven't done any feature engineering. And since this is a time series, I highly recommend to use something like standard deviation or mean at least to create additional features. And in later tutorials, I definitely want to use more sophisticated features. But let's have a look how the actual data actually looks like. So if you plot a lot of data, we clearly can't make out if there are any clusters or not. It just looks like a complete single point cloud. So what we do is we just sample the data a bit down. And here we already can make out that there might be a cluster here. And I tell you that there's a second cluster there. So let's actually increase the number of samples a bit. And here we clearly can see that we have a cluster with a low intra-cluster standard deviation. And I can tell you that here's the second one with a high intra-cluster standard deviation. So that's how the data looks like. That's how the algorithm performs. So with 83% of accuracy. And the reason why this algorithm is not performing perfect is because we have one cluster with a low intra-cluster standard deviation and another cluster with a high intra-cluster standard deviation. And we will see that other algorithms are performing better on such a data set, for example, DBSCAN. But today we will just stop with that. And let's see what we can achieve in future tutorials using this data set. Bye.